Welcome to the Business Credit and Financing Show. Each week, we talk about the growth strategies that matter most to entrepreneurs. Listen in as we discuss the secrets to getting credit and money to start and grow your business. And enjoy as we talk with seasoned business owners, coaches, and industry leaders on a variety of topics from advertising and marketing to the nuts and bolts of running a highly successful business. And now, to introduce the host of our show, financial expert and award-winning author, Ty Crandall.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the show today. I'm really excited you could join us because today we're really going to be talking about how you can unlock the performance traits of the most successful entrepreneurs. So what's interesting is that we've got a guest on that's really going to share kind of some patterns that he's found and some methodology he's actually developed to kind of hone in and unlock the key performance traits of the most successful entrepreneurs. And once you know that, then you're easily able to duplicate some of those traits, bring them over, and enjoy some of that same success. So with us today is Alex Charfen. And he is co-founder and CEO of Charfen, a training, educating, and consulting organization helping visionary entrepreneurs grow and scale their business and movements and create a momentum everywhere in their lives. So a private advisor and consultant to billionaires, the Fortune 500, and some of the most well-known entrepreneurs on the planet, entrepreneurs on every continent except Antarctica, uses his online courses to change their lives. So Alex has spoken on entrepreneurial awareness around the world for tens of thousands of entrepreneurs and top global businesses, including TEDx, Genius Network annual event, and EOs Global Leadership Conference in Athens, Greece. At his recent Titan Summit event in Zurich, best-selling author Robin Sharma introduced Alex as the most progressive entrepreneurial mind on the planet, which is pretty impressive. So for the past two decades, Alex has created and curated proven business philosophies, models, and strategies, and geared specifically towards entrepreneurs and the entrepreneur personality type, the EPT, which is really interesting, something I want to dive into with him. And he's a nationally syndicated contributor to the American City Business Journals and regularly is called upon by national media outlets. So pretty impressive, Alex, man. Thanks. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, thanks, Ty. You did your research, man. That was a great introduction.
Yeah, and I want to, just in case I mispronounced it, your last name is Charfen, right?
That's it.
Okay, I thought so, but then I actually even think I said it a little bit wrong. But I finally got it right if I did. So how long have you been an entrepreneur for?
Oh, man, that is such a loaded question.
That's why I ask it.
So, Ty, I'll give you like the short story. You know, I was always one of those kids who was exceptionally different. When I was younger, adults would attenuate their voice. You know, it would be like, oh, hey, look, there's Ty, there's Jennifer, there's Johnny, and Alex. And so, you know, ever since a very, very young age, I have been exceptionally different, you know, and I feel like I've been an entrepreneur my whole life because I didn't belong. I didn't feel like I really, you know, I was socially incredibly awkward. I mean, I'm awkward now and I'm an adult. I can't imagine what I was like as a kid. And so I feel like I've been an entrepreneur since I started. I knew I was different than the people around me from when I encountered people outside my family. I have always had that feeling of innate motivation of kind of being pushed and, you know, kind of motivated and driven to do more, driven to create bigger outcomes and figure out what's going to be bigger in the world. And I feel like I was always an entrepreneur. I didn't always have that perspective, but now in retrospect, I know that this is just who I am.
That's great, man. That's awesome. What got you into kind of what you're doing now?
So that's another awesome question. So I'll give you the shortest story I can, Ty. So in, you know, as a kid, I was different and I didn't really spend a lot of time around other kids. I started businesses. When I was really young, I sold stuff to my neighbors. Then I sold candy at school until they made it so they outlawed me. I had a window washing company in high school that I had to sell because I was too young to be running it. I had a financial consulting firm in college that I ended up selling out of. It sounds impressive. It wasn't a great sale or anything, but I went and ended up on the other side of the country, and by a series of fortunate events, became a Fortune 500 consultant. And at 21, I started working with companies like Fuji and SanDisk, Logitech, Microsoft, Belkin, big multinational computer and consumer electronics companies. And I've spent my entire career either as an entrepreneur or supporting and working with entrepreneurs. And as a consultant, I spent time around some of the most successful people in the world. I was allowed to be in the C-suite at major corporations where I was dealing with people who had nine-figure and sometimes 10-figure wealth. And my obsession with entrepreneurship and business and success started when I was very young. I was so different that I didn't lean into normal systems to find success. I started reading as a kid obsessively about successful people. I started with self-help. And Ty, you maybe have had this experience. You know, you read like two self-help books and you start getting some momentum, but then you get to like self-help book number 10 and it's conflicting with number two, and book number eight said six was wrong and book number five said all the rest of them were invalid. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I know exactly. Yes.
It's like the self-help tango that you, like, you don't really, and the problem is, you know, I started reading these books really young and I couldn't reconcile that level of incongruency. So I pivoted and started just reading about successful people obsessively. I read the life stories of anyone I could get my hands on. And I went out looking for this thing called success because I felt like I could never get there. And what happened was I kept seeing a reflection of myself. You know, I started reading about people like Einstein who couldn't tie his shoes or ever in his life. He wore slip-ons his entire life and couldn't talk until he was four. Failed algebra twice. I'm like, hey, I'm a lot like Einstein. Socrates, who was so antisocial that and so stubborn that he ended up taking poison just to so that he didn't have to admit he was wrong or tell someone else that they were right. And I'm like, I'm just as stubborn as Socrates. You know, Pythagoras, who figured out more equations than anybody of his day, and really maybe anybody in history besides maybe Einstein, was so antisocial that he was seen as somebody you shouldn't be around. And Newton, who discovered gravity, was sitting under an apple tree when an apple hit him in the head, but we don't know the part of the story that he was sitting there by himself because he was seen as a loner and had really a hard time relating to human beings. And the more I read about stuff like that, the more I started seeing myself in that reflection. And so after a career of working with entrepreneurs, a few years ago, I sat down and I was going to write the book on how to run a company, how to build a company. I've done it over and over again. I've taken one to 250. I've taken five over 10 million. And so I was going to write the definitive book called Constructive Company. And I got to the part of the book proposal where I had to describe my client, entrepreneurs. And Ty, I couldn't. I had 300 words and I just couldn't make it big enough. I couldn't make it important enough. Like, I'd been studying entrepreneurs my whole life. I'd been studying successful people my whole life. And I couldn't describe it in 300 words. And I remember the weekend like it was yesterday. I was writing and I got up and I went and told Katie, like, I'm in this part of the book proposal where I have to describe my client and I just can't. And I remember feeling just irrevocably stuck. And I got up, walked around, came back and sat down. And it was like all the highways in my head that were going in different directions suddenly converged into this superhighway. And I started typing. And later that weekend, I had written 22,000 words of a book called The Entrepreneurial Personality Type. And what happened that day was that all of this research I've done, I've read about thousands of successful people throughout history. And I've met with hundreds and some, you know, probably thousands of successful people in real life. And I've worked with and mentored and been able to coach and been coached by some of the most successful people in the world today. And what it all came down to is that we are so much more alike than we're different. And I wrote this treatise, this manifesto called The Entrepreneurial Personality Type. And Ty, it was one of the most vulnerable and exposing documents I've ever written because I was writing about me. It was my argument to defend who I am and how different I am. And I remember at the end of that weekend, taking about maybe 2,000 words of what I had written and copying it and putting it on Facebook. And I remember like copying and hitting Control V and having the post on Facebook and thinking like, should I post this? What if people make fun of it? What if they think I'm crazy? Like, what's going to happen? And I hit post, and within a minute, confirmation started coming back like, oh my God, I just read this and nobody's ever explained me like this before. And, you know, I didn't realize that this is who I was until I just read this. And there was this almost immediate confirmation that this argument that I had created meant something. And so that's how the entrepreneurial personality type and my work around the habits of billionaires and the billionaire code and what I do today, that's how it started.
So what is, I mean, can you kind of, I mean, because obviously a lot of work went into what you did. Can you break it down? I mean, what is this EPT you're describing?
You got it, brother. So I'm going to do it in two ways, if that's okay with you. So first, I'm going to give you the shortened version. Entrepreneurial personality types are momentum-based beings that are highly sensitive to constraint. So when I say the word momentum tie, do you hear it or do you feel it?
Feel it.
No question, right? And like when I say being in momentum, do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, absolutely.
What does it feel like when you're in momentum, Ty?
For me, it feels like I'm moving quickly.
Do you have that feeling of like ecstasy, of like you can't lose, like that everything's going right for you?
Oh, it's definitely a high, absolutely.
So here's what's interesting, Ty. When you look at our small segment of the population, the entrepreneurial personality types, first, we're the minority. But when you look at who we are physiologically sensitive, momentum-based beings. We feel. We don't experience the world cognitively. We feel the world and our brain interprets it. We are those who get up every day, demand there can be a better future. We come back to the present and we go out and make it real. And so the entrepreneurial personality type is exactly that. And here's what I know about people like us. When we are in momentum, we are physically, cognitively, and chemically boosted. Like Ty, I'll ask you, when you're in momentum, do you know you can do more, you think more clearly, and you actually experience a chemical high?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay, so that's who we are. And we exist in three states. So I just shared one of with you in momentum. The second one is facing resistance. This is like that time in our lives where we don't have the right resources, we don't have enough time, we don't have enough money, we don't have enough. And the world around us is saying, hey, you should get a job, or you should stop, or you should go do something else. But we are focused on our outcome. And we can see that small light at the end of the tunnel. And everyone around us is like, it's a train. But we can see, and we move towards that light. We shut out the noise and pursue it. We make it, compel it to come closer to us. And then eventually we step through it. And that is exactly where we, in fact, create our lives. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Absolutely, yeah. So that's really interesting. I never really thought of it that way, but you're definitely right. I mean, that's how I think all the time. Is just 100 mile an hour in this natural high where, like, I love to work. And, like, my wife thinks that's insane, right? Because, like, the last thing she would ever want to do is work. And a lot of people around me the same way. But, like, for me, that's my high. That's what gets me excited. So you say this is so rare, but I mean, like, what percentage of the population kind of are in this way that kind of fit that EPT?
Well, let me explain that in just a second. I want to give you the third state we exist
Okay,
in.
my bad, my
Let's
bad, my
jump
bad.
into that. No, don't worry about it, Ty. Because here's the third state. And I want everyone to think about this one, because this is where people like us get into trouble, Ty. You know, I don't think that people like you and I really understand the difference between happy and sad. And I know that sounds a little crazy, so play with me for a second. I don't think we understand the difference between that wonderful world of emotions that the rest of the world lives in. You know, you might have figured out happy and sad, like happy's on, sad's off. But the fact is, what's the difference between sad, frustrated, pissed off, ticked off, confused, upset, and just plain not going to talk to you? To me, go ahead.
No, I'm not sure.
Right. Because to us, it's either on or off. And the fact is that the rest of the world lives in that world of emotions. We live in momentum, facing resistance, or the third state, which is in constraint. And Ty, this is that time in our lives where we can't see the light at the end of the tunnel, where we don't know our next moves, where the situation, the people around us, where we feel full constraint. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Absolutely.
I do. You know, I think all of us do. And you know that feeling of like not being able to see the light at the end of the tunnel? How fast does your body start breaking down, Ty?
I would think fairly quickly.
For me, it's minutes. Like I
Yeah.
get exhausted right away. And how fast does it start getting confusing to make decisions?
Very quickly when you're at that point.
And here's the big one. How quickly do you start feeling that chemical rejection of being in constraint?
Immediately.
Right. And what happens is when we're in constraint, we break down. We look diagnosable. We look, you know, dysfunctional. It looks like we can't actually create momentum. And the people around us can get scared of us because we're different than the rest of the world. So the entrepreneurial personality type is this physiologically sensitive, momentum-based being that's highly reactive to constraint. And we live in three states: momentum, facing resistance, or in constraint. And our entire purpose is to stay in momentum. Because Ty, here's what ends up happening. When I go in front of a room of thousands of entrepreneurs and I say, what does it feel like to be in momentum? People say ecstatic and incredible. And you know, it's like sex, it's like being high. It's like, and then eventually somebody says, it feels like being alive. Because for people like you and I, we feel alive when we're in momentum, creating progress and making things happen. That's why you love work. You say you love work. I would say you love contribution and you love what you do because you're making a difference in the world.
Yeah, I'd agree with that completely.
And so that's who we are. And when you ask, you know, what percentage of the world is entrepreneurial personality types, I have kind of a process that I want to go through with you so that you can self-diagnose as an EPT. You already have, but I want to really pin this down for you and make it real. And I want to do it for all your listeners too. So for you and everyone listening. So I see the world differently than the most people do. See, I see four different types of people out there, and I'm going to go through each of the four and let you self-qualify which one you are. So evolutionarily, I've done a ton of research on human beings, on like, how did we evolve? How did we get to where we are? And I don't mean evolution in the argument of creation versus evolution. I don't want to offend anybody, but in your dogma, in your belief system, in your understanding of the world, just fast forward to when there was human beings, and it doesn't matter where they started, human beings are evolving. We can see the evidence of it today. I mean, you can see the evidence of it in the last 25 years of just football players getting bigger and stronger. You know, I look at my kids and they're so much more intelligent than I am. They're so much more aware than I am. Human beings evolve. And when I look at this evolutionary history we have as human beings, I see distinct types of people that all had functions evolutionarily and today. So the first group of people in the greater human existence is what I call the caretakers. And caretakers are the people who want to take care of other people. And it's interesting, Ty, when I speak to entrepreneurs, often they'll say, oh, that's me. Because people like you and I want to help people. We want to contribute to people. We want to move them forward. Wouldn't you agree?
Absolutely.
But here's the qualification question for caretaker. So the way you qualify or disqualify yourself is to answer this question. Ty, do you like changing bedpans?
No. And I've done that before because I was a medic in the Air Force. So I can definitively say, no, it sucks.
But here's what's interesting, Ty. You were a medic. And you know that there was people who were medics that if I said, hey, do you like changing bedpans? They would congruently and passionately say something like, well, Alex, if that person needed a bedpan changing and I was there and I was able to be of service, then I feel fulfilled. That's exactly what I should be doing. Do you know what I'm talking about, Ty?
Sure, I get it. Yeah.
It's not who we are, though.
No.
But do we need those caretakers in the world? And did we need them in our human existence in the last several millennia? Absolutely. Because guys like you and I would run away from the bedpan.
Sure. Absolutely. Yeah. I appreciate those people for doing it so we don't have to.
Me too. Me too. I mean, the caretakers, you know, in a lot of ways, they support the entire world. Now, that's the first, and that's a big population of human beings. So when you look at our greater human existence, the greater human tribe, that portion, that group, they have a huge purpose, and it's helping people in the moment move forward, supporting the human tribe. That's caretakers. The second group is the communicators. And what's funny again, Ty, is as soon as I bring up communicators and I say, hey, these are the people that like to communicate, like to share oral tradition, like to talk, like to let people know what's going on. Entrepreneurs like you and I always say, well, that must be me. But here's the qualifier for communicator. Ty, do you enjoy small talk?
No. Well, no. I definitely don't enjoy small talk. I'm more of a get to the point. I think my wife will say it as I commonly say, don't build me a clock, just tell me the time.
Right, because small talk drives people like you and I crazy because there's no outcome. But when I look at our evolutionary human tribe, we needed the communicators who are willing to talk about anything, willing to talk about the weather, willing to talk about the cliff over there, willing to talk about don't eat this because it'll kill you, willing to talk about the woolly mammoth that's threatening people over there. And so we needed that communicator to bind together the human tribe to carry on oral tradition. But clearly, it's not you and I. We're not communicators. I can't stand small talk. As soon as it starts, my first thought is, how do I get out of this?
Right? I'm with you. Yeah, I'm with you. I'm with you.
And somebody goes, hey, it's pretty hot out there. I'm like, when is weather a relevant conversation? Right? And so So we're not communicators, but again, we need them in the greater human tribe. So the third group of people, so we disqualified you as a caretaker and a communicator. Let's see if you're the third group. I call them the coordinators, but my code word for them is the memorizers and the organizers. These are the people who love details. They love to put things in order. They love the red tape, the nitty gritty. They love contracts, not because there's a deal, but because there's a contract. Now, very rarely does an entrepreneur say, that's me.
No, that's not me.
Here's the disqualifier or qualifier question, and I'll ask you. How many committees have you volunteered to be on in your life?
Not very many. I mean, I'm going to say not very many, but I can't really think of any.
Right. And how many committees would you volunteer to be on in your life?
No, never. I'm not saying I might not ever, but there's no purpose for that for me.
Right. And here's why. Because people like you and I don't like the function of a committee. We don't like the coordination. We don't like the gavel. We don't like the fact that you have to wait till a meeting to get anything done. And so, but coordinators love committees. My father-in-law, or stepfather-in-law, we don't really get along, but my stepfather-in-law is a coordinator. He will proudly tell you he sits on 25 different committees. I'm like, where is the blue tip would exit?
Yeah, I'm with you. I agree.
That would kill me. But did we need coordinators for our human tribe? Of course, we needed people to tell us when the seasons were and when to save up for winter and to keep track of things. Because again, guys like you and I wouldn't be doing it. And so if we look at this human tribe and we say we have the caretakers, the communicators, and the coordinators, that's how we evolved throughout history. There's a fourth group. What's missing in order to lead our human evolution?
Leaders.
Yeah. And here's how I see that evolutionarily, Ty. We are the evolutionary hunters. We are that small fraction of the population that gets up every day, creates a better future in our mind, comes back to the present, and demands that it become real. We are those who are willing to face the vulnerability and exposure of changing the status quo, of making things new, of making things better. We are the evolutionary hunters. And when I look at that small segment of the population, that is us. Here's the qualifier question. Can you turn it off?
No.
No. And you know what, Ty? The rest of the world can. Because the rest of the world, when you look at people who aren't like us, they are doing things like, you know, every night at around 7:30, there's a show like Wheel of Fortune that plays on network TV. And Ty, if Wheel of Fortune doesn't play one night, the station gets thousands of phone calls of people saying, I want my Wheel of Fortune. Can you ever imagine making that phone call?
I can't have imagined never watching Wheel of Fortune. So no.
Because we're different than the rest of the world. And here's why, Ty. When I say, can you turn it off? And you say, no. I want to show you how functionally and obsessively different we are than the rest of the world. When you look at a caretaker, a communicator, a coordinator, they function, they live, and they succeed in the present. Those are all present function activities. Would you agree?
Yeah, absolutely.
Being a hunter, being like you and I, an entrepreneurial personality type, we are future-focused human beings. We go out into the future, discover new possibilities, come back and make them real. So when you look at the rest of the world, we are this tiny minority that challenges everything every day. And we get up, and while the rest of the world strives for average and clings desperately to the status quo, we say, how can we make it better? How can we make it bigger? And how can we improve the conditions for our greater human tribe? And when you look at the human condition, we are that small percentage of the population that actively evolves humanity. So I don't know what percentage it really is, Ty, but here's what I know. We're the minority. We live in the future. We think different than the rest of the world. And if you or anyone listening has ever thought, I think that person just doesn't like me just because of who I am, I want to confirm your suspicions that it's absolutely real, because the evolutionary hunter threatens the rest of the human tribe. Not all of them, but I will tell you there are factions within caretakers, coordinators, and communicators that will do anything they can to legislate us, red tape us, push us, and suppress us out of existence because we threaten theirs.
Wow, that's powerful. And it sounds like what you're saying, I mean, these aren't things you can learn, right? I mean, you either have it or you don't.
You know, Ty, I don't know that it can be taught or not taught. But what I know is that anyone who's listening to you and I right now is probably one of us. And for anyone listening, if you have that place in the back of your mind where you know you're meant for more, and you've always had that hallucination you were afraid to share with anyone, that you could change the world and that there was a bigger outcome for you here and that you were capable of more, you can do more, you can contribute more, you can make more happen, here's what I want you to know. The fact that you're asking the question in your mind is confirmation that you are one of us. And I know that every entrepreneurial personality type at some time in their lives, usually more often than not, feels isolated and alone and like no one understands them and like they are a party of one. Do you know what I'm talking about, Tom?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So here's what I want everyone listening, including you, to know. If you think back through history of anyone who matters to be remembered, anyone who you remembered, think back to the people who matter to you. I've shared some of mine with you. I think of the people I've read about, Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle, the guys who asked too many questions sitting in a room, Pythagoras, the guy who was convinced he was going to figure the world out, Newton, who wanted to understand how the earth itself actually worked, Picasso, who locked himself in a room and painted in blue for so long that a period of what we would call extended manic depression is a period in art history created by an individual human being. When you think back through history, I want you to recall the names of anyone who remember, who you remember, anyone who matters to you to be remembered. And I want you to know they were just like us. And for anyone who's felt isolated and alone and like a party of one, that is your tribe. That is who you are. And that is your responsibility to show up in the world.
Wow, that's awesome. I mean, it's powerful, Alex. I mean, I never thought of it this way at all. And you find in studying, you know, the most successful people out there that really they're following exactly the same patterns, right?
It's intense, Ty. When you look at the entrepreneurial personality type, we are so consistent in how we show up in the world. We all develop momentum the same way. We all have this need to move forward. We have this clear need to be on the hunt. And here's what's interesting, Ty. I'll ask you a question I've asked thousands of entrepreneurs. When you approach a goal, does it lose importance to you the closer you get to the finish line?
No. When I approach a goal, does it lose importance to me the closest I get to the finish line?
Yeah, like as you're...
I got to be honest. I mean, the way that I look at it, yeah, I think I do lose interest because right. I'm already on to the next step in my head. So I actually kind of have a tendency to kind of abandon things right at the finish line because I'm bored at that point, ready to move on.
Well, you know what, Ty? I look at that as evolutionary programming. And, you know, for anyone listening, whatever your faith is or your beliefs are or however you look at the world, I'll share with you mine. I believe that there is absolutely a higher consciousness, a higher power, a higher direction at work here because human beings are just far too perfect and far too extraordinary to have existed in any other way. And when I look at how we are programmed, how you and I and all of you listening are programmed, we are programmed that as we approach a destination, it loses importance to us. Well, what part of the tribe would do that? The part that as we kill, it loses importance because hunters don't stand around and celebrate a kill. You know what they do? They go right back on the hunt again because the tribe has to eat, the tribe has to evolve, and the tribe has to survive. And so we are programmed the same way as every great entrepreneur before us, that as we achieve, it loses importance and we must move on to a greater hunt, a greater outcome, and a greater contribution in the world. That is who we are.
Yeah, and that's, I can't tell you how powerful that is because it's very true. I mean, everything you're describing is exactly how I am. And like you said, it's interesting to know that because, you know, we do think of ourselves as so unique. And so it's good to find that we're actually in the company of others, as you mentioned, a lot of the greats. So what kind of habits do you see the guys that you've studied, the self-made billionaires kind of using or following?
Ty, you know, when you look at entrepreneurs who operate at the highest level and you look at how they think of the world, it's just completely different than most of us. And I'll share a couple of the habits with you. So probably the most important is that billionaires don't tolerate anything that they don't want to. They limit what they tolerate. In fact, when you look at wildly successful entrepreneurs, their tolerance level is very low for anything. Like I have a friend who's worth more money than you and I could spend in a lifetime. And if he goes into a meeting, into a boardroom, and there's someone or something there that he doesn't like, he literally will turn to the people he's with and say, hey, you guys handle this meeting, I'm out, and walk away. Because here's what he knows. If he's in a meeting that throws him off for an hour or 2 hours or a day, or someone who frustrates him or annoys him, it's not worth it. So he leaves. And billionaires tolerate very little. They set up their lives so that they're comfortable. They set up their lives so that what happens is programmed, so they get communicated with in the right way, so that they're not thrown off guard. And when you look at the average entrepreneur today, it's like they're in a contest to see how much they can tolerate.
Yeah, I completely see that. And, you know, one of the big things is overwhelm, I think. And entrepreneurs probably, from what I see or experience personally, take on too much. So have you kind of learned any tactics on ways to overcome that overwhelm that kind of comes with this natural EPT that, you know, is the general makeup of who we are?
Absolutely. When you look at entrepreneurs in general, and in all the research that I've done, there is a clear pattern that successful entrepreneurs have followed in order to create massive outcomes in the world. It's four steps, Ty. We call it the contribution equation. And I just want to clarify something. When I talk about contribution, here's how I look at it. I'm a capitalist. When somebody says, what political party are you? I say capitalist, because the two that we have today don't represent my beliefs. I think that capitalism is a near perfect system because we created fiat currency where you and I can exchange money for contribution. What is more human than that? And when I say contribution equation, I want you to know that in a system that is working, capital flows to the greatest contribution. And with every entrepreneur I've ever worked with, their desire to make a living is coupled with their desire to make a contribution. And there's a point in time in every one of our careers where making a contribution is more important than making money. Not that we ever stop wanting to make money, but the contribution aspect of it raises an importance to where if we're not making a contribution, the money doesn't matter. And so the four-step process that I've watched over and over again, and I observed in the lives of every successful entrepreneur we've ever seen, is simple. The first step is you lower the pressure and noise in your life. Ty, most entrepreneurs look like they're in a competition to see how much pressure and noise they can accept. You watch people on Facebook or on Google or on Instagram, and it's like, I'm hustling and I'm working and I'm doing as much as I can and I'm running nonstop. And the fact is, when we raise the level of noise in our lives, we lose creativity. Our field of vision narrows. Our proximity to our goals gets further and further away, and we don't see all the possibilities. So as an evolutionary hunter, I want to compel you to start right now, today, lowering the pressure and noise in your life. That means that if you're not treating yourself like a million-dollar racehorse, I ask why. If you're not treating yourself like a professional athlete, I ask why. Because if I had a million-dollar racehorse, you would know it was $1 million just by looking at it, and every one of you is capable of making millions of dollars in your life. Every one of you has the influence potential, the affluence potential of a professional athlete. So treat yourself like one. Lower the noise in your body. Hydrate, move, breathe. Do the right things so that you feel better every single day. If you're not taking care of yourself, you are not optimizing your success as an entrepreneur. And when I say lower the noise, be ruthless, be relentless. Look at the people, the places, the things in your life. They are either giving you momentum or they are taking it away. Don't let that happen. Lower the noise. Eliminate anything that isn't moving you in the direction you want to go. So step one is lower pressure and noise. Step two, and this is a hard one for people like us, Ty, you have to ask for protection and support. And here's why I say it that way. In entrepreneurs, there are strengths that should be protected and everything else should be supported, because not one of us can reach our full potential alone. We hunt in packs. We are good when we work together. Our strengths can offset someone else's challenges. And the faster we understand how to ask for, transparently as possible, protection and support, we start moving in the direction of actually achieving our life's goals. So we lower pressure and noise, we increase protection and support. And if you do those two things, here's what happens almost automatically. Your strengths and abilities will show. They will get better. They'll actually increase. Ty, haven't you had the experience of someone asking you a question or maybe speaking and having someone say something, and then you give an answer and you walk away thinking, where the heck did that come from?
Yes.
Well, dude, that's your strengths and abilities. They just show. You know, I'll stand in front of a 1,000-person room of entrepreneurs and I'll say, how many of you are using the skills and abilities that you learned in school to create your success today? And typically, maybe one hand will come up. So what the other 999 people, how are they doing it? It's from the time in between. It's when you lower pressure and noise and you increase protection and support. We get stronger as people. We see greater outcomes. Our field of vision expands. The possibilities expand. Our ability to create new results in the world gets that much better. And so step one is you lower pressure and noise. Step two is you increase protection and support. Step three is your strengths and abilities will show. And that brings us to the final step. You make your greatest contribution. Because if as a human being, you're willing to lower the pressure and noise in your life, remove the things that are taking away your momentum, make sure that there is no operational drag that you are carrying around, your velocity in life will increase. And if you take step two and you start telling people not the BS that we're taught to say as entrepreneurs, all that fake it until you make it and never let them see you sweat, because we all know that just means lie and deny. Instead, get raw, get real, tell the people around you what's really going on, the protection and support you need, and it will show up. And if you do that, you will see your strengths and abilities develop at a rate that might even surprise you. And then you will naturally ascend to making your greatest contribution in the world. That is how every great entrepreneur in history has done it, and it is a path every one of you can follow as well.
That's powerful, man. You know, Alex, I appreciate your enthusiasm, man. I appreciate your energy, you know, and you've learned so much about this that, you know, what's the next step for an entrepreneur? I mean, you know, what steps can they take, you know, with you and the research you've done to kind of learn more about their own EPT, to learn these things that you've discovered, to learn, I think you compared it to an athlete. I think that makes a lot of sense. I mean, what are things that somebody can do in business to really focus on their maximum achievement, their maximum ability to achieve?
Well, first things first, I would suggest that you do two things. One, go to momentumpodcast.com and check out my podcast. It's first person. It is an interview, but it is just insights and perspective for the entrepreneurial personality type, for the evolutionary hunters in the world. And I don't talk to everyone. I just talk to us. And the second thing is go to freemomentumbook.com and download the entrepreneurial personality type book, the book that I wrote that weekend. It's not exactly what I wrote that weekend, but that's when it started. And it's been edited down to about 8,500 words. You can read it in 90 minutes, but it is a manifesto on who you are. And I assure you that book will tell you more about yourself than anyone or anything ever has. And then when it comes to creating the outcomes you want in the world, here's how people like us actually create momentum. You must know what you're on the hunt for. Create clear outcomes in the world. Create perspective that shows you if you're moving forward, and then make sure there's accountability to what you're doing and the people around you are doing, and you will get predictable results. When we know where we're going and we have a scoreboard telling us if we're going to get there and we have the support we need and we're supporting others, that's when we increase our velocity. That's when we move forward. That's when we create our outcomes.
All right, so everybody, you heard where to go. So momentumpodcast.com and freemomentumbook.com. I'm going to put both of those on the show resources page. Alex, man, I really appreciate you coming on. This has been really eye-opening and one of the most energetic and awesome podcast shows I think we've done. So I really appreciate you coming on, man. You've been an amazing guest.
Ty, it's my pleasure, man. I appreciate the chance to talk to your audience. And depending on how the response comes back, I'd love to come back for a round two, brother.
Yeah, listen, I appreciate that. And I could definitely see that happening in the near future. Listen, everybody, I think you went through what I went through during this show, which is, yes, wow. I mean, he's describing me in a way that nobody else has ever described me. And I think just in the limited time we've had that we're just scratching the surface of this EPT model that Alex has been able to develop. So make sure you go to freemomentumbook.com, freemomentumbook.com to get more on the EPT. Make sure you visit momentumpodcast.com as well. I'll put both of those on the show resources page and dive deeper into this. And then you're also able to connect with Alex. I'm sure that he, Alex, you have some, what do you do coaching? What other kind of things do you do to help entrepreneurs kind of grow and find their maximum and accomplish maximum achievement?
Absolutely, Ty. We have a product called the Momentum Masterclass, which is all the personal habits, skills, morning routine, evening routine, everything you need as an entrepreneur to lower the noise, increase the protection and support you have, and achieve maximum momentum as quickly as possible. And then we also work with million-dollar plus companies. So if you're an entrepreneur who's running a business that's achieved at least $1 million in gross revenue or the run rate of $1 million in gross revenue, which is about $80,000 a month, we have a program where we help entrepreneurs build teams, build the communication structure for a seven-figure business that will take you to an eight-figure, nine-figure, and if you desire, even a 10-figure business. I've done that for most of my career, and it's the most exciting thing in the world to give entrepreneurs frameworks that release the full potential of the evolutionary hunter so we can go out and create the new realities in the world that make things happen.
Awesome. So listen, you know, there's three resources I want to put on the resources page everybody should check out, which is charfen.com. That's CHARFEN.com, momentumpodcast.com, and freemomentumbook.com. Make sure you dive in deeper. There's a lot more that Alex can teach in the 40 minutes or so that we had together. So make sure you check out those three resources. And again, Alex, it's very, very, very special. Thanks, man, for coming on the show with us today.
My pleasure, Ty. Thanks for having me, man. And for everyone listening, I appreciate the attention and the time today, and I just have a single statement that I end every podcast with. There is nothing wrong with you, and you are not alone.
It's powerful. Alex, thank you so much. Thanks, everybody, for listening. Make sure you check out momentumpodcast.com and freemomentumbook.com. Again, we just scratched the surface here for what you have to learn, and you'll learn a lot more on these links. I'll make sure they're available on the show resources page. Thanks, everybody. Have a great day.
You've been listening to the Business Credit and Financing Show with your host, Ty Crandall. Watch for our next episode to get even more insight on financing and growing your business. And don't forget to check us out online at creditsuite.com for even more business growth strategies.